At Personal Democracy, we like to think Personal of ourselves as community weaver.
We manage
in the last few years to bring people together. The two founders of Personal Democracy Media, Mika Cipri and Andrea Shea, were
not here
today.
They like to say that one of the metrics of the success of our conferences
is the number of cards that are exchanged.
Diciamo il numero dei biglietti a visita scambiati, cioè quello che può essere costruito da questo. Noi creiamo conferenze, noi creiamo una comunità pronta a collegarsi. Come ho detto prima, noi abbiamo iniziato con l'IFA in Europa. La prima conferenza è stata tenuta a Barcellona nel 2009 ed è lì che io ho incontrato Anthony Amel, il nostro prossimo relatore. Ci ha fatto vedere allora delle cose molto interessanti, una mappa molto interessante della blogosfera politica europea. In effetti se ne parlava poco.
Very well done, and
è stata fatta molto bene, soprattutto ci ha aiutato a capire per esempio la storia che può essere raccontata. Abbiamo ascoltato oggi data, delle storie, abbiamo parlato di dati, ma è anche molto importante che si possano raccontare le storie in modo tale che sia possibile raccontare il numero più alto di persone possibile. Ecco perché Anthony sta lavorando su questo. Usano i dati per raccontare
like
delle storie,
BBC or the Times,
usano i media come Times o BBC, oppure think tank come Chatham House o altre e think tank per raccontare delle storie, per utilizzare un'enorme quantità di dati per spiegare come le cose funzionano e come le cose possono verificarsi. E questo è uno dei punti di cui parlerà Anthony oggi e questo può essere fondamentale per avere un dibattito pubblico più formato e più ricco. Grazie.
Thank you,
grazie,
well, thank you for
grazie
that,
per aver detto delle cose così gentili di me.
E allora
forse lei potrebbe venire a lavorare per noi.
Comunque
si parla tantissimo di dati oggi, cosa non sorprendente, anzi tutti i giorni se ne parla.
So it seems that
e allora sembra che abbiamo
data,
big data,
personal
open data,
data
dati personali.
Some say we have entered a data era, and data is in the new oil, and you've heard all of those.
And maybe dati sono come data petrolio, are eccetera, eccetera.
All around us. If you look at Google and Grand Books, I mean, you can see that there was not a lot of talk about data in the 19th century, but it's been growing steadily in the 20th century.
Vedete la crescita, abbiamo avuto un picco negli anni 80.
Actually, talking about the 1980s, it reminds me of one of my first memories around data. And actually, when I have that memory, it's a very vivid image in mind. It's not a graph that comes to mind. It's actually this. And this is May the 8th, 1988. So I'm 9 years old back then. I'm riding my bicycle, you can picture me, on this street in Lildavet, a small suburb town outside Paris where I lived back then with my family.
It's about 8 p.m.
So it's a nice spring evening.
Era una sera on my bicycle, and
all of a sudden I hear this scattered clamor coming from all around all the nearby houses,
and that clamor is the noise that data makes.
François Mitterrand, on that day, has just been re-elected to the French presidency, taking 54% of the vote with him against 46 for Jacques Chirac, his opponent. And I remember that during the spring of that year, I had been following the open polls, these small numbers, very, very simple, 52, 53, and the opposite, and wondering how they unleashed such passions, they created such heated conversations, whereas I can tell you, in the mathematics lesson that I was following in the classroom, there was no heated conversation of any kind.
So I was wondering how these numbers created these, and this is an image that stuck with me, and so
portare tutto ciò. E allora, se questo mi porta ad oggi, come è stato detto oggi, abbiamo sempre più dati, abbiamo tante opportunità e possiamo capire un pochino meglio il mondo grazie a questi dati. Ma questa è una sfida. Come rendere tutti questi dati accessibili, disponibili, come capire delle cose?
Bene, per essere sicuri, You can answer that. That's a safe and accurate answer.
Se noi
option
number
margine
two, errore, possiamo
displaying
dare una
the experts
precisa,
in the sample.
Oppure,
the no side has 95% chances of winning. If you know something about confidence intervals, like maybe those who answered option two, that's
vincere,
good. Option number three, the one that's interesting, the no side has 48% chances of winning. If you have ever been faced with a poll, if you've ever read an article around the poll, there's no way that you're going to answer that the no side has 48% chance of winning. You should look at that. Well, let's look at our small results. All respondents, two-thirds did well, a very small minority seemed to be expert in the field, but you have a quarter of respondents who answered something that is, simply put, pure nonsense. I mean, there's no way that that poll says that. If you drill down a bit, you'll see that female respondents did markedly better than average, that's good. Men, conversely, did
questo per gli uomini e questo
so,
per le donne.
But if you look at the bright side, I'm sure that
la parte
to women mostly, most men are the
diciamo
majority of the time being purely nonsensical, so this might be an improvement compared to other fields of life. So just a third, we didn't do as bad as that. So as you can see, it's an issue because even these simplest numbers sometimes can be misleading. So how do we, and I'm talking from a design perspective because this is what I'm saying, how do we make it so that people understand the data?
This is
something we did recently with the BBC. Around the Scottish independence referendum, we built a poll tracker that allowed to gain perspective, to detect trends over time, to compare sources, and more importantly, along with it, where expert analysis and opinions from journalists always explaining what the numbers meant, what the new trend, what the new directions meant. And for instance, if you take the welfare state, it's been an important feature in the public debate in Scotland, and you would have journalists explaining how the promise of more devolution by the British government to Scotland at the end of the campaign, notably with respect to welfare state, may have played a role in helping the no back up and take the day when ballot came.
So we have journalists telling stories. So
this is what we call data telling. It's about the meaning we can weave around data.
Cioè
and we should just throw them out there. We should be concerned with data telling. So how do we go about conveying meaning and telling stories around data? So let me share two examples with you. The first one has to do with Mo Ibrahim.
Esempio,
Mo Ibrahim is a Sudan-born British citizen who created and subsequently sold the first mobile network company that was across different eastern countries in the continent. And it established a foundation that awards prizes along with financial endowments to deserving heads of state and governments will have contributed to lifting their countries out of poverty and will have respected good democratic principles like leaving their office when their term ends. And to do that, the Mo Ibrahim Foundation is using data. They have established the Ibrahim Index for African governance, and this index is there to steer the conversation of experts, journalists, opinion leaders, mostly decision makers, so that they stay clear of broad, often ill-conceived opinions about the African challenge, because there is no one African challenge, but so that they can drill down and look at the issues that matter country per country. So let me give you an example, and let's look at the Ibrahim Index for African governance. So if you look at the main indicators, you have there are four of them, and beneath there are different sub-indicators. There you have some sort of, let's say, not a surprising hierarchy in terms of African countries, in terms of wealth, of income. This is maybe what you have in mind. So you can see the darker countries are the ones better off according to the index. But then, if you drill down and if you take something like safety and rule of law, a different picture emerges. And especially if you look at national security, for instance, you'll see that national security is not an issue for many African countries, except maybe for a handful, like a corridor at the center. So this is not an issue that we should spend too much time on. But if you look at personal safety or accountability, a different picture emerges, that of a lot of African countries where a lot of progress still needs to be done. These data, they inform the narratives of journalists around African countries. For instance, take Liberia and the election of Ellen Johnson Sirleaf in 2005. And this and the democratic exemplarity of the country has translated across indicators, and it's something that journalists can use to have a better conversation about Liberia. Talking about Liberia and West Africa, unfortunately, Liberia, Guinea, and Sierra Leone, as we all know, have been plagued by Ebola for the past 6 months. And if you look at West Africa, you can see that these three countries are, so to speak, in the middle of the pack in West Africa across indicators. But if you drill down and if you look at health issues, you'll see that they are actually lagging behind the other countries in West Africa. So they are the ones doing the worst with as far as public health is concerned. So when the Ebola crisis has been corrected, and hopefully it will be soon, or in a few months, this is something that can inform the conversation. This is something that experts in the field, like these two, Bill Gates and his foundation, or Hans Rosling, the famous public health professor. Yes, public health professors can be famous these days thanks to TED Talks. By the way, don't expect me to do any sword swallowing at the end of my talk today, as he would, I'm sure. So they understand that they support a more intelligent conversation, and that's why the data are there, that's why the index has been made available, and that's why a story is told with the index thanks to journalists as well. Now let's look at another example that's been in the debate for a long time. This is it, Inequality and Capital in the 21st Century, a book you may have heard of. It's interesting because Thomas Piketty, the author of the book, has been both praised and vilified by people who usually hold opposing views around inequality. It is a good thing because we need to remove ourselves from our echo chambers. It's something that we often talk about at the Personal Democracy Forum, echo chambers. And a book, its work, its data, its story, that bring people who have opposite views like these two, although they're not around anymore. It's interesting. And so everyone has a say about inequality. Brilliant experts, economists have been arguing around inequality for years. You may believe that inequality is an issue, is a bad thing, because everyone should get a fair share of income and wealth, or you may think it is not an issue, so long as everyone stands to benefit from the growing wealth around us, even if on unequal terms. What matters is that you may believe something to be true or false. And in that respect, I'm a bit like Plato. I'm distrustful of public debates that rely mostly on mere opinions or beliefs. I would rather have facts and data to fuel our public debate. And so it's a good thing whenever someone comes up with a lot of data. And this is indeed what Thomas Piketty has been trying to do for many years. Intellectual and political debate about the distribution of wealth has long been based on an abundance of prejudice and a paucity of facts. And he offers to redress that, to add data. But it's not just adding data, actually. It's also telling a story. Everyone has been talking about the book, and actually you might say, okay, so everyone has been talking about the book, many people have read the book, so why am I here today talking about Piketty, and what can I say more than what's already been said? Well, of course, course, everyone is talking about inequality, everyone is talking about the books. So this is Google Trends News, and you'll see that there's been a great spike around Thomas Piketty. But it appears there are still more pressing issues. In yellow, the hobbits. People are much more concerned about hobbits than about Piketty and inequality. I don't know what that tells us about us as a society, but I like that one. So the rest, I think we should still talk about Piketty and about inequality. Plus, some of us may have not read the book in full. This is a very unscientific experiment by the Wall Street Journal, showing that on average, people who began Piketty's book stop at page 10, whereas many novels, I'm sure that Hobbits would be more read. So I've heard ministers in France, in Europe, elsewhere, presidential candidates in the US, journalists, pundits, say that they are not at time, that is, if they were being polite to read the book, or that they are not bothered, that is, if they were being honest, to read the book. So I think we should still try and make that story, make those data more accessible and not just available out there. So this is what we've attempted to do, just begun at Applied Works, studying Thomas Piketty's book. So it's a lot of data, but it's also a story. And actually Thomas Piketty lays different... we call them narrative nuggets before it gets to inequality. So the way the bricks are laid need to be studied and need to be understood before we can get to inequality and the solutions, the advisors, whatever one ends up thinking about his solutions or his recommendations. And he begins the story, Piketty, with someone called Kuznets, an economist I must say I had never heard of before, though he's a Nobel recipient from the early 20th century. Kuznets was one of the first modern-day economist to study inequality dynamics. He did so at the turn of the century, leveraging the advent of universal income tax, because along with the fiscal benefits from there, rose data. And this is important, this is one of the main points of Piketty. We need income tax, universal income tax, and maybe universal wealth tax, just for the sake of having data. So Kuznets was based in North America, he studied different, he had different indicators, as you can see below, and it was in a short period of time. There were many authors before Kuznets, to name a few, you have heard of them, Malthus, Marx, Smith, or here Smith, yes. Who had had very piecemeal data. I mean, there was no data collection in the 19th century or before, but they leveraged those data to take a stand and to deliver brilliant interpretations. But as you'll see just right now, Piketty is the first modern-day economist to have leveraged the wealth, the trove of data. So this is how much data Piketty has compared to the other economists. In time, in space, across indicators. For that simple reason, Piketty's book, Piketty's story should be listened to. And this is why we want to make it even more accessible than it is today. So this is just the beginning. And we should, in the coming weeks and months, and maybe some of you will want to contribute, and that'd be great, study different narrative nuggets, income and growth, capital and wealth, and other, to get to inequality, which is the conclusion of this book, and the welfare state. I've talked about it. It's also one of the things that is an important part, an important narrative nugget of this book. It's something that was present in Scotland, that will be most certainly present in the debate in Spain around Catalonian independence. Maybe in Italy, I know there's an ongoing debate, like in Belgium, around the autonomy of provinces. So it's something that's important and that we should take care about. So I'll just leave you with a bad paraphrase, often I'm sure, of Shakespeare. That would go something like that, if we apply it to our subject, our subject matter. Our data fly up. I mean, they're interesting, but our stories stay below. However, data without stories never to heaven go. Never do they fly high enough. So we need those stories to support the data. Thank you very much.